This is Radio Ecoshock with Alex Smith.
We live in times with faint hopes amid darkening despair. This week, an ancient cathedral burned. A criminal politician got away with it. We pump millions of tons of global warming into the atmosphere. More species staggered towards extinction. And a 16-year-old girl tried to wake Europe and the world. In this program, NASA scientist Peter Kalmus explains how he slashed 90% of his personal emissions. Senior South American reporter Sue Branford warns the Amazon rainforest, the lungs of the planet, is not just dying, it is being murdered. Then we will hear 16-year-old Greta Thunberg's speech to the European Parliament. I'm Alex Smith. This is Radio Ecoshock.
Down here on the corner of ruin and grace, I'm growing weary of the human race. Hold my lamp up in everyone's face, looking for an honest man. Everyone tied to the turning wheel, everyone hiding from the things they feel. Truth's so hard, it just don't seem real. The shadow across this land.
We are destroying the life support systems our children and grandchildren will need. We don't mean to, but we do. Something has to change, and author Peter Kalmus says it's us. I need to be the change. You need to be the change. Peter Kalmus is a hybrid. By day, he is a published climate scientist at NASA's Jet Propulsion Lab in California. The rest of the time, Peter and his wife find ways to opt out of these deadly systems, and he was named as one of the 10 visionaries in the 2018 Grist List. Peter wrote the book Being the Change, Live Well and Spark a Climate Revolution. It is stuffed with realistic stories and charts full of tips how to get off this climate-killing ride. The book has since been turned into a film available on DVD. From Pasadena, California, Peter Kalmus, welcome to Radio Ecoshock.
Hi, Alex. Thanks for having me. I should say I'm speaking on my own behalf before we get going.
Right. Now, before we dive into alternative culture, please tell us what you do as a scientist.
So I'm an atmospheric scientist, and I'm also a data scientist. So I've spent some time studying clouds off the coast of California and other marine areas of stratocumulus clouds. So stratocumulus is overcast cloud, and it looks pretty bright from space. So it's reflecting a lot of sunlight. So depending on how that changes in the future in a warmer world, it could help mitigate global warming or it could make it worse. I also have recently started doing some work in the area of ecological forecasting. So that's using data science to help bridge the gap between the Earth system model projections of, for example, temperature, sea surface temperature, you know, other variables, and how those changes, those projected changes in the future, are going to translate to changes in our ecosystems. So in particular, I'm embarking on a three-year research adventure studying how these projected changes will affect coral reefs in greater precision than has been done before.
And you did an anonymous poll of Earth scientists. How are they handling the terrible news about climate and destruction of the biosphere?
Oh, that's a tough question, Alex. I handle it personally by trying to do everything I can to raise the awareness that this is an urgent issue. That's sort of, you know, action for me is kind of the best medicine. You know, was just talking to some of my colleagues today at a nearby university, and I gave a seminar and I talked to several of them sort of one-on-one in meetings throughout the day, and I was really surprised by how many of them were kind of on the same page as I am, at least in private, and how, you know, some of them expressed that they are, it takes a little bit of courage to speak out, but they're looking for that courage, and I think that's wonderful. I think there's been a real shift over the last few years in the earth science community, and it's tough. I mean, as scientists, we didn't necessarily get into this to speak out and to be in front of the public and to communicate about this. Most earth scientists are just fascinated by the earth system and do this work because they love it. And, you know, I'm a little bit of an anomaly. I was doing astrophysics for almost a decade, and I got increasingly concerned about climate change, so I intentionally switched into the field. But many of my colleagues, especially my older colleagues, they didn't start in earth science from a sense of urgency. They just started from a sense of fascination. And then as they're studying their system and they're seeing these changes and the implications are unfolding to them, you know, they're faced with a tough choice whether to just keep doing science or to start sounding the alarm and speaking out. And more of them are starting to choose the latter, I think, as the impacts are becoming more clear and, frankly, more frightening.
So why do you think that just laying out the science and the facts about climate change isn't going to do it? It isn't going to bring real action?
Yeah, it's a fascinating question and probably better posed to a psychologist. You know, I think there's probably a lot of reasons. If there's a problem that's kind of very a very deep part of our identity, something that's either tribal or part of our worldview, perhaps, you know, if we've been working in industries that are contributing to the problem our whole lives and like really trying to make the world better, you know, and then, you know, some young people come along and say, actually, what you've been doing this whole time is making the world worse. That's not like necessarily a good thing to hear. You know, if an authority figure from perhaps for our, like a political party that we affiliate with says that it's not happening, and for whatever ideological reason we want to believe it's not happening, it makes it easy to justify that. You know, you have scientists are somewhat authority figures, but a tribal leader, someone, you know, an ideological leader that we associate more deeply with is going to take precedent over the scientists and, you know, make it easier to kind of justify throwing away the evidence or at least not examining it too closely. You know, as a scientist, I think most scientists are, we like evidence a lot. And, you know, a true skeptic, when presented with evidence contrary to his or her views, will change his or her views according to the strength of the evidence. That's real skepticism, and that's what science is based on. And unfortunately, a lot of the people out there who call themselves climate skeptics are actually the opposite of skeptics.
You know, you wrote in your book about something where you felt a kind of internal fracture, and that really resonated with me because while I make climate radio every week, I need to drive sometimes a couple of hours to visit our grandson, and it's very difficult to cope with the guilt of helping to harm the world, even though you don't mean harm, and that's something we all need to overcome, and I think there's a few ideas in your book that can help us do it.
You know, I tend to like to talk to people, and I'm fascinated by people who really try to find ways to reduce fossil fuel use in their life. I think that kind of exploration of how we can live with much less fossil fuel, even before the systems and the infrastructure catch up to us, it's, to me, a really curious and interesting adventure. But even though I probably rub elbows with people like that more than the average person, I have yet in my entire life to meet a single human who doesn't burn any fossil fuel. So I personally don't think purity tests or shaming are helpful in any way. But at the same time, I do think it's very useful, especially for advocates and leaders in the climate action movement. And some of them are scientists, some of them are not scientists. But if it's your goal to try to raise a sense of urgency that this is really a very urgent issue facing humanity, it's incredibly useful to start looking for ways to reduce your own fossil fuel use. And a lot of those advocates, I think, they're deeply aware of how much harm burning fossil fuel causes. So that's another good reason to look for ways to reduce. But it's important also to be gentle. For example, one of my biggest sources of emission in 2010 was my flying. And it took me 3 years to ramp it down from about 50,000 miles a year, which is pretty typical for a lot of academics, down to zero. I had to talk to my parents and kind of like change their sense of like me being able to just jump on a plane really quick and visit them. I was starting a new job and sort of had to kind of, you know, set those expectations that I wasn't going to be flying. So I still go to meetings and conferences that I can get to without flying. But, you know, it took me a while to get that to that point, and it's probably easier for me to do that since I'm in Southern California. So there's a lot of opportunities to collaborate here in California. There's a lot of conferences that come, you know, right here to Pasadena, or if not to Pasadena, then maybe in the Bay Area, that are pretty easy for me to get to. And if I really need to go far afield, you know, maybe once a year I can take a very long train ride, even though that's a little bit expensive time-wise. But my point is, no matter where we are, no matter what limitations we have, what privilege we have, we can all look for ways to reduce in some ways, but it's unrealistic to expect that we can go all the way to zero until the systems and infrastructure around us catch up. And the reason it's really good for us to try to get out in front of the culture and push for reduced fossil fuel use is to try to get that kind of cultural shift and, you know, help those systems and that infrastructure to change more quickly. So if no one is basically voting with their actions to use less fossil fuel, then I think, you know, the urgency is not going to be conveyed as quickly. The exploration isn't going to happen as quickly. And, you know, the cultural shift and the system change will take longer.
How much did you manage to cut your personal carbon emissions when you set out on that adventure for the book?
About 3/4 of my emissions were from the flying. And at the same time I was cutting the flying, I changed to be a vegetarian. I looked for other ways to cut my emissions. Those were sort of the big things. Yeah, interestingly, I started to find ways to get some of my food from the waste stream, and eventually that turned into a relationship with a grocery store, which unfortunately recently ended, but for several years I was able to get food that they were going to throw away and use that to feed my family, and that, you know, good to keep that out of the landfill so it wouldn't just turn into methane. Yeah, so when I started, I was a little bit over 20 metric tons per year, which is pretty close to the average for people in the U.S. And, yeah, over several years, I managed to reduce that by about a factor of 10. So it was mostly due from cutting out the flying, and then changes I made to my diet were sort of the second most significant set of changes. So that was becoming vegetarian and getting some of my food from the waste stream, which eventually, you know, turned into a relationship with a local grocery store, and I went and picked up some of their spoils, what they were going to throw away. Took a little bit of for it myself, and then donated it to a local church community. So that was pretty nice. And then riding my bike was also helpful for this. And it's I love talking about biking because it's one of those things that is absolutely a delight to me. And I would keep doing a lot of it, even if there wasn't any climate change. You know, it's a great source of exercise. And I don't know if it's the way I'm wired or if it's a common thing for a lot of people, but it makes me really happy when I'm on a bike.
A listener gave me a fabulous cargo bike, and it's made in Seattle. And now I can get my groceries and other heavy stuff up to 180 pounds safely on my bike. I just think cargo bikes are a great idea.
Yeah, biking is something everyone should do. You know, as biking infrastructure gets better, you know, more protected bike lanes and more people out biking so that cars are more aware of bikers, it's only going to get safer and better. It's sort of a chicken and egg problem, especially here in Los Angeles. There's not a lot of biking, so there's not a lot of demand for, you know, good protected bike lanes. And so that keeps more people from biking. But it's a shame because it's such a healthy thing, actually. You know, there are very few ways to actually improve your health. If you're you know, the average person gains a lot of, you know, extra time on this planet basically just by biking because of lowered risk of heart disease, it turns out.
Yeah, it's such a shame. I mean, Vancouver just put in quite a few bike lanes. They had to fight the car people all the way. And I can see that Los Angeles is the hub of car travel. I mean, more cars are sold in California than in most countries. But it's such a shame that North America is so far behind Europe in using bicycles for clean, healthy, fossil-free transportation. It drives me crazy.
Yeah, and it's a good example of how hard it is to change the status quo, right? And that's exactly what we need to do here for getting off of fossil fuels. I mean, this is not really a technological problem or a physics problem so much as a human problem, right? We're all too accustomed to burning these fossil fuels, and we're not imaginative enough to sort of see the alternatives, which is why I think it's important for at least a few of us, and hopefully for more and more of us, to start to explore these alternatives and maybe to realize and to spread the message that it's really not so bad to live with a tenth of fossil fuel. The biggest change, I think, for most people, as they look at my lifestyle, would be giving up flying. And there's a lot I like about the no flying. And I urge people to try to fly less. You know, I don't, again, it's that sort of middle path approach where it's pretty unhelpful to tell people, you know, just stop doing something. But if everyone can try to fly a little bit less and that becomes a little bit more of the norm. For me, I was flying too much before and it was kind of exhausting. And, you know, I wasn't really part of my community here where I lived and I didn't see my, you know, kind of got homesick too often for my family. So I definitely prefer flying less. It's tough, though. I know people have to fly for their jobs. They have, you know, parents that live far away. Sometimes they have long-distance relationships. I hear that a lot, and I understand that it's tough. But the problem is, you know, the atmospheric radiative system of greenhouse gases and photons, it doesn't care why we fly. It only cares that we're emitting that CO2. So that's why it's such a hard thing.
I remember being in a church hearing George Monbiot speaking in 2006. He'd written his book, Heat, and he talked about the biggest problem with flying is love miles, that you're going to see your relatives, the people that you really love. And so he said, what we're going to have to do now is look for a mate if you're going to get married or have a relationship. Look for somebody who lives close to you and try and see if their family lives close to you and try and keep your family close to you, so that you will be able to see the people you love without wrecking the atmosphere.
Absolutely, and I think that's a great example of how actually some of these changes could be better, because, you know, I think with the advent of planes, we all got accustomed to living really far away from each other. I guess some people maybe don't have good relationship with their close family. That might be a good thing, but, you know, I definitely miss my parents. You know, I settled here in Los Angeles, and they're still in Chicago where I grew up. It's a bummer. You know, I wish I lived closer to them. I kind of made this move before I was so aware of the urgency of climate change. But, you know, I still manage to see them about once a year, usually by train.
Well, and didn't you drive there in a vegetable-powered car?
Yeah, several times. That was a sort of hobby of mine, to convert an old Mercedes to run on vegetable oil. And then I was fascinated with kind of how fossil fuel is hidden from plain sight. You know, you put the gas pump in your car, you don't actually realize how much stuff is going through that hose and into your tank. Same thing when you get on the plane. You don't realize just how massive all that fuel is that makes the plane go. The infrastructure, the refineries, the mining operations, it's like all kind of hidden away. So I was sort of fascinated by that. And, you know, I'm like, let me see if I can get this fuel myself. I've actually stopped driving in that car. In November, I decided to buy an electric vehicle, which I love. And it was a big decision for me because I like the hands-on sort of experience of getting my fuel myself. But what I started to like less and less was the fact that even though the used veggie oil wasn't contributing to climate change, and it was great to keep that old 1984 car on the road, I didn't like the fact that it's still making particulate pollution, which is bad for health. All the kind of garbage particles that we put into the air, it's going into our lungs too and making a lot of us sick and decreasing our lifespans. So I'm starting to become very aware of that, and I, you know, don't like to make the air dirty either. So yeah, the electric car is great. I actually drove that to Chicago one time, and it worked fine. It was just as easy as driving a gasoline car, and actually a lot easier than driving a waste veggie oil car because, you know, you have to worry about the fuel there and, frankly, you know, keep it from breaking down.
Check out the Radio EcoShock website. We're at ecoshock.org.
This is Radio EcoShock. I'm Alex Smith. My guest is Dr. Peter Kalmus, the NASA scientist who tells us how to be the change, live well, and spark a climate revolution. He's speaking not for NASA here. He's speaking for himself. And I want to tell listeners, in New York, the Reverend Billy has established the Church of Stop Shopping. And you, Peter, tried out a 46-day trial of opting out of buying things. How did that go?
That was a lot of fun. That was actually my wife's idea. So we still bought food, but that was pretty much it. If there was like a kind of a serious maintenance issue, you know, maybe like a bike part or something, we'd buy that. But yeah, we basically didn't buy anything for, I think it was her idea to do it for Lent, since she observes Lent. And it was surprisingly easy. We had a Prius that we forgot to fill up. with gasoline before we started it, so there was only like 1 gallon in there. So we bartered some eggs from our chicken to a friend and siphoned some gasoline from his gas tank, which was kind of fun. It was all just done in the spirit of fun.
And this whole system, though, and you write about this in the book, is designed to make us buy, to want more things and to create more emissions. And when we try to stop, some people get very critical. They can get upset with us. They can get angry. Have you and your wife experienced pushback when you try these new things?
Probably the most pushback I get is from, you know, flying less advocacy that I do. You know, it's so ingrained as part of, for example, the academic lifestyle that it's pretty radical to suggest that we could fly less. And I think it feels a little bit threatening. I found that a lot of my colleagues are actually starting to fly less. You know, just the other day, one of them said that he went to a panel. He flew to it, and he felt that there was a little Peter sitting on his shoulder. So I don't want to make people feel guilty, but I guess sometimes that's what happens. But then he said something really interesting, which was that, but he realized I was right, and that particular panel wasn't worth the flight. And so I think, you know, even the people who are pushing back against the flying, it's at least getting them to start to think. And I think that's the process of changing norms. You know, I think more and more people are starting to come around. You know, we definitely recognize, I want to really drive this point home, that we can't solve this problem by just a bunch of people changing voluntarily. We need structural change. We need systems change. This is just one way among many ways that we can try to push for that.
You know, I think you can refer your flying colleagues to Dr. Kevin Anderson, the deputy director of the Tyndall Center. He won't fly anywhere. He took a boat to Iceland for a conference, and he takes trains to Europe, but he's definitely going down that route. And you just touched on a very important question, though, which comes up thousands of times. Isn't it pointless to cut our personal emissions when someone else on the other side of the world will just burn that carbon anyway, or we got to wait for big government action, they say?
Yeah, well, you know, I think it's a really tempting excuse to use to say that, you know, I don't have to change. I'm aware of the problem, but I don't want to change and I don't have to. I'm just going to say that all we need is systems change. If you're trying to make these reductions to keep your own CO2 out of the atmosphere, and that's the main reason you're doing it, it's not really sustainable because you quickly realize, like you said, it's too big of a problem for that, and that's not the way to a solution. But if you frame it as doing all this stuff for cultural shift, then I think it is sustainable, and it feels like you're kind of amplifying these changes through, you know, kind of talking to people, maybe writing about it, and just setting an example, which is shifting the norms. And we have so little time now to avoid the worst effects of climate change that it can feel frustrating. You know, this process of cultural shift is slow. But, you know, over the last year, it's amazing how much has changed, way more than I would have expected. I think what happened was some scientists have started speaking out more, and you know, a lot of Earth scientists are seeing these really frightening changes in the Earth system, didn't quite know how to deal with that, didn't know how to communicate about that. And so some scientists, some of us are starting to speak out with a greater sense of urgency, with what I would say is an appropriate sense of urgency that the public can understand. And that shifts the norm. You know, those scientists speaking out, they're fine. You know, other scientists look at them and say, oh, they're kind of saying the things that I'm thinking or maybe that I'm talking about in private. And so then they start speaking out more too. Then you get an IPCC report, which is making the urgency of the need for action really clear. So that's a special report on 1.5 degrees Celsius of warming, which came out in 2018. And suddenly the youth reads that and they say, wow, this is like a huge existential threat to our lives. So they take to the streets, they form movements, they start to get involved in politics. And suddenly here in the U.S., we have all of the Democratic nominees talking about climate change, which was something that was unheard of just a few years ago. You know, we had presidential entire election cycles where climate change wasn't even mentioned, right? Which for those of us concerned about climate change was extremely frustrating. And this is just the beginning because these movements now, you know, the norms are shifting. I think the early shifts maybe are the hardest shifts, and the impacts are getting more frequent and more intense because that's physics. This is maybe the first social movement which is being driven by underlying physics, which is kind of coming from an exponential increase in CO2 in the atmosphere, right? So that's going to keep increasing until we take action. And if that's driving the social movement, I think it's safe to say that the social movement's only going to get stronger, and politicians and policymakers ignore it at their own peril.
And you end your book with the value of meditation. How does meditation help us deal with this climate angst and maybe our anger that things aren't changing fast enough?
You know, meditation, first of all, it teaches us in a very deep way that we're all connected, and we're connected with non-humans and the natural world too. It's easy to sort of assume that we're separate from everyone else and we're separate from the natural world. You know, the environment is something out there. And that's simply not true. And in a world of sort of accelerating ecological crisis, that becomes more and more clear, right? And then second, meditation gives me the tools to basically kind of be with this difficult knowledge and in kind of acting in this difficult space, but to not necessarily take it so personally, right? So I know, like, I'm limited. I can only do the best that I can do. I can try to advocate for change as skillfully as I can. I can try to do my science as skillfully as I can. And if I get all depressed and sad and anxious, then I'm not going to be as effective, and I'm also not going to be as happy. Yeah, it's a little bit strange to kind of be able to know this and to work in this space and to still be happy.
Well, I want to let you get to your family, so I'll just ask one last question. Let's say our listeners get your message here. They want to start being the change. Can you suggest just a couple of first steps?
I would say the very first thing is to try, if they haven't yet, to try to find a community of like-minded people. This is necessary for sanity. It's necessary for inspiration and for kind of mutual support. So you get ideas from these other people. The one that I joined when I moved to Southern California, and it really helped me, was Citizens Climate Lobby, which pushes for a revenue-neutral carbon fee, which is one of the policy steps that I think we should take. I don't think it's the only thing we should do by a long shot, but I think it's one thing that would be good to do sooner rather than later. So yeah, joining a community like that, I think, is super important, however that comes to pass within a person's community. Talking about this, that kind of goes hand in hand with joining the community, but also starting to talk about this with almost everybody, with coworkers, with family members, educating yourself about what's happening. There's a lot of good ways to do that. There's a website called skepticalscience.com, which is a good place to start. It debunks a lot of the misunderstandings about the changing Earth system. And then in terms of actually reducing one's own fossil fuel use, the best place to start there is to actually try to figure out where those emissions are coming from. My book in Chapter 9 sort of helps you do this, but, like, you know, how much of your emissions coming from flying versus driving versus food and so forth. I actually made a team. It's a great team with some developers and some other people for an app, which is called Earth Hero. So it's not out yet. It should be out pretty soon, and it'll help make this process easier. And again, framing it in terms of cultural shift as opposed to just keeping emissions out of the air.
We've been speaking with Peter Kalmus. He's a NASA scientist and author of the book Being the Change, Live Well, and Spark a Climate Revolution. I'm going to put links to Peter's website in my show blog at ecoshock.org. And this book is full of charts and tips and step-by-step things, so I really recommend it. Thank you so much, Peter.
Thank you so much for having me, Alex.
You're listening to EcoShock Radio for the world.
I'm Alex Smith. Get it all at our website, ecoshock.org.